This video is brought to you by Skillshare. The fall of Western Rome is undoubtedly one of, if not the greatest tragedies in Western history. The empire that once toppled its savage neighbors with ease and brought them the culture and order of Europe's then greatest and most advanced civilization had itself been toppled by barbarians. Such a fate was, unfortunately, one brought on largely by Rome's own decaying social and political structure. The Roman Italians had lost the valor and discipline which once made them so great, and increasingly the roles of soldiers and politicians came to be filled by Roman Gauls, Pannonians, Illyrians, Moesians, Thracians, and Anatolians, all of whom were at greater threat of attack by Rome's enemies, and as such saw firsthand the troubles of the empire and sought to correct them, while the Italians existed comfortably within their sheltered, wealthy, well-developed cities. Ultimately, after the frontiers collapsed, these cities fell as well, including the great city of Rome. But by that point, the West had long fallen to the wayside of the greater empire, being surpassed by the eastern provinces as the center of Roman commerce and culture, something which too contributed to the decline of the West. The rise of the eastern empire, what would come to be known as Byzantium, allowed fragments of Roman civilization to endure, albeit heavily influenced by the region's Greek population. Italia was left in the hands of the barbarian-made King Odoacer, who himself was recognized by the Byzantine Emperor Zeno as the rightful ruler in Italy, the one who was still subject to the authority of the higher-ranking emperor. That was easier said than done, as Odoacer exerted free reign as king and even acted against the best interests of the Byzantines. That's not to say Odoacer was a poor ruler, however, as he himself sought to emulate and improve upon old Roman practices and seemingly aspired to rebuild Rome's old republican institutions, laying much of the groundwork to turn the Kingdom of Italy into a promisingly powerful state. All of which intimidated Emperor Zeno, sensing this as a challenge to his title. As a result, Zeno sent Theodoric, king of the Ostrogoths who lived along the Byzantine border, to invade and resettle within Italy, removing the Ostrogoths as an immediate threat to the empire and ousting Odoacer as a potential rival. With that, the Byzantines had essentially washed their hands of the West and turned their attention to the mounting challenges both within the Eastern Empire and at their doorstep. But before going any further, let's take a quick moment to thank today's sponsor, Skillshare. Skillshare is a massive online learning community that provides ad-free classes in every kind of subject, from animation to management. Whether you're interested in building a new hobby or improving upon a work skill, you'll find something to suit your needs through Skillshare's detailed and tailored service. I've been making the best use of Skillshare by exploring classes that'll help me improve upon the quality of my videos. Most recently, I watched Animating with Ease in Adobe After Effects by Jake Bartlett. For a more introductory class, I'd also recommend Making Animated YouTube Videos by Evan from Polymatter. For anyone who's just starting out and looking to create their own animated YouTube videos, it'll definitely be a big help. For the month of October, Skillshare is offering the first 1,000 of you to follow the link in the description a full free month of membership, so go on and take advantage of this offer while it lasts. Now, back to the video. Without the Romans of the West as a bulwark against the barbarian tribes, Byzantium was left virtually alone in the world, surrounded by enemies including Rome's age-old rival of Persia, who would instigate a four-year-long war with Emperor Zeno's successor, Anastasius, prompting the construction of new fortifications along the border with Persia. Anastasius would also reinforce the Anastasian walls in the West to protect Constantinople from Slavic and Bulgarian attacks, giving us a glimpse of how important, reliable, and extensive defenses were becoming in this turbulent age. Fortunately, Theodoric did well to keep some semblance of order in the West as an ally of Byzantium during this time, but that quickly disintegrated following his passing. Anastasius' successor, Justin I, would pass away just 1 year after Theodoric and hand the throne down to his nephew, Justinian. Justinian was an intelligent and ambitious young man who was afforded a high-quality education in Roman faith, history, and law by his uncle Justin, then merely a commander of the royal guard. Justinian would go on to serve as a close advisor to Justin upon his ascendancy to the throne, from where he earned a first-hand look at the inner workings of Rome's political machinery before himself rising to the position of emperor upon his uncle's passing. Justinian entered into office with two grand visions: the forging of a grand legacy for himself as one of Rome's greatest leaders, and the restoration of Rome to its former glory. His studies and upbringing had instilled in him a deep admiration for the empire and the men and laws which built it. He came to see Rome as the Empire of Christendom and felt it was his divine obligation as emperor to expand its borders and preserve its culture. He grew up with stories of a civilization once so powerful, proud, and prosperous that to see the pathetic state of what little remained filled him with a burning passion to restore that lost greatness. He would go on to review and revise the entirety of Roman law from taxation to moral and religious conduct, preserving codes that might otherwise have been lost to time, while streamlining and updating contradictory, ineffective, and superfluous laws. The Corpus Juris Civilis, sometimes simplified as the Justinian Code, eventually becoming the basis for much of the legal code within the Western world, and at the time serving as the solid foundation upon which Byzantium would continue to build itself, enduring until the empire's ultimate collapse. Beyond laws and reforms, Justinian sought to physically revitalize the empire through the construction of several grand new structures which inspired and reminded the people of Rome's eminence and capabilities, the most famous of these structures of course being the Hagia Sophia, an enormous cathedral, the largest of the time. Truly, Justinian was an adept politician, but that only made for half of a Roman emperor, for the leaders of Rome are conquerors as well as statesmen, and though Justinian himself was not a battle-hardened general, he had at his disposal perhaps the greatest general in all of Byzantine history, Flavius Belisarius. Belisarius during Justinian's early reign had proven himself a loyal soldier, though his prowess was yet to be fully demonstrated. Some of his abilities shone through during the Iberian War, which actually took place here rather than here, and his loyalty was further tested during the Nika riots. The Iberian War had seen peace brokered between the Byzantines and Persians, but not just any peace, an eternal peace, one that was meant to end the counterproductive wars between the two equal empires, and allow them to focus not on harming each other but in defeating their shared enemies as well as pursuing their own personal agendas. For Justinian, that meant one thing. It had been roughly 6 decades since the fall of the West, and while the Byzantines maintained a very fragile order in the region through the mostly loyal barbarian kings, that too appeared to be crumbling. Ostrogothic power had fallen to a boy and his pro-Roman mother, and several within the state now began seeking a return to Germanic tradition in the wake of this weak leadership. In North Africa, the Vandals, who had finally appeared to begin rapprochement with the Byzantines, had relapsed, replacing the pro-Roman king Hilderic with his traditionalist cousin Gelimer. In Justinian's eyes, the window of opportunity for Roman reunification had not yet closed, but this change in the Germanic kingdoms was signaling that it was approaching. Having just cause to retaliate against the Vandals, Justinian sent Belisarius to attack the kingdom and seize territory which might be used to facilitate a gradual reconquest. However, Belisarius had caught the Vandals off guard, finding that they hadn't prepared any significant defenses, and sensing the opportunity, took it upon himself to conquer the whole of the Vandal kingdom at once. Soon after this campaign, the pro-Byzantine queen of the Ostrogoths was imprisoned and assassinated by her cousin, who then proclaimed himself as the kingdom's sole ruler. In response to this, Justinian ordered Belisarius to continue his conquest by advancing into Italia, ultimately bringing it back under Roman control. Just as it appeared the total reunification of Rome was falling into place, the Persians broke the eternal peace and forced Byzantium to shift its focus away from the west and back to the east. With the consolidation of power within Italia not yet complete, the Ostrogoths once again broke away and attempted to reconquer the peninsula for themselves, only to be defeated once again, but at great cost. With the peninsula depopulated, fortifications destroyed, and the Byzantines exhausted, the Franks attempted their own invasion but were repelled, and for the time being, Italia stood secure. Once again, a power struggle emerged in another Germanic kingdom, that of Visigothic Hispania. And seizing upon the opportunity, the southern coast was annexed by Byzantium, bringing the empire to its territorial height. However, holding these territories would prove difficult, as the Byzantines would be rocked by tribulation after tribulation. The war with the Persians carried on, causing much destruction and siphoning away much-needed manpower from the west. The Justinian plague eradicated an estimated quarter of the empire's population, stifling every aspect of Byzantine life and function. And a massive earthquake and tsunami caused extreme damage to the East Mediterranean coast. Justinian did not live to see his territorial achievements gradually fracture away, but nor did he succeed in reunifying the whole of the empires he had hoped. His succession would be complicated by the death of his most capable heir, leaving the throne to be assumed by one of two men, both named Justin. One, a magister militum and consul with diplomatic and military experience, the other, an older but largely unremarkable candidate. Justinian is alleged to have named the latter Justin as his successor just before his death, but only one man was witness to this claim. Despite this dispute, the unremarkable Justin took the throne and assassinated the rival Justin. His reign would be marked by war, madness, and the loss of northern Italia to the Lombards. The empire would never reach these heights again. But what if all that changed? What if in an alternate timeline, Rome reunited? There are two key factors which dramatically crippled Byzantium's ability to continue the Western conquests and even to retain what they had held. That being the constant conflict with Persia and the poor leadership which followed the reign of Justinian. It was the believed eternal peace with Persia that first allowed Byzantium to turn its attention westward, and it was the resuming of conflicts in the east that ultimately forced the Byzantines to drop their attempted reunification of the empire. Remove this factor and Italia could have been stabilized, its fortifications rebuilt, and its population spared a second period of warfare. It was the ambition and ability of Justinian that brought nearly four decades of progress and revival to Byzantium, and it was the weak leadership which followed that brought about stagnation and an inability to solve the empire's troubles. The Justinian Plague certainly dealt a devastating blow to the Byzantines, but its impact was widespread, affecting the empire as well as its enemies. And nowhere was it more effectively dealt with than within the empire. As great a threat as it was, Justinian demonstrated tremendous competence in dealing with it, but the empire simply could not withstand the plague, the war in Italy, and the campaign against Persia all at the same time. We could easily argue that the plague was a third key factor and suggest that if it, along with the other two factors, were removed from this timeline, it would allow for Roman reunification. However, there is a very simple way by which the first two factors, the long war with Persia and the issue of Justinian's succession, could be realistically solved with just one or perhaps two changes. Germanus was a cousin of Justinian and one of his most promising generals, carrying under his belt a series of impressive victories and having been described as the most inspiring of Byzantium's generals, respected by Byzantine and barbarian alike. He even married Theodoric's granddaughter, earning himself a place in the Ostrogothic royal line, and he was, of course, Justinian's foremost choice to succeed the throne of Byzantium. Shortly after the breaking of the Eternal Peace, Germanus was tasked with the defending of Antioch from a Persian invasion led by the king Khosrow himself. Dramatically outnumbered, Germanus had no choice but to retreat, allowing the Persians to sack the major city and embolden them to continue their aggression with the confidence that Byzantium could not sustain a two-front war. But this time, things are different. In this alternate timeline, Germanus, provided with a much larger army as a show of force against the Persians, draws a decisive victory against Khosrow at Antioch and pursues him back to the Persian border. Believing he has misjudged Byzantine weakness and fearing an invasion of Persia would undo all his centralizing reforms, Khosrow would desperately attempt to re-establish the Eternal Peace, finding himself forced to make concessions for the construction of new frontier fortifications, securing the Byzantine border from future Persian attacks. The swift ending of this war not only brings Germanus great acclaim, but allows Belisarius and a greater military presence to remain in Italia, securing it from a barbarian resurgence and subduing Gothic resistance north of the Po River. This spares Byzantium an additional decade of war in the peninsula, along with all the men and resources it would have cost, including those domestic to Italia, leaving it in a stronger state than it would have been following the additional warfare of our world. This would have all been achieved before or near the very beginning of the Justinian Plague, leaving Byzantium in a relative state of peace and stability when the outbreak occurs, thus allowing Justinian to focus on mitigating its impact on the empire. Because the war in Italia does not linger on, Germanus is never put in charge of a military expedition to combat the Goths as he would have been in our timeline, and thus is never placed in the circumstances which caused him to fall ill and die just prior to setting sail. Perhaps he was bound to succumb to this illness either way, but for the sake of this timeline, we'll assume that isn't the case, thus allowing him to remain Justinian's heir apparent, with Germanus's son, the competent Justin we mentioned at the beginning, to succeed Germanus after that, giving us two more generations of competent leadership which shared Justinian's vision of a reunited Rome. As the plague subsided, so would opportunity present itself in Hispania as it had in our timeline. The Byzantines, having suffered significant population loss but retaining far more strength than in our timeline, proceed to conquer not merely the southern coast but Hispania in its entirety. By this point in time, Justinian would have approximately another decade left to live, and hoping to follow up the reconquest of Hispania, he set his sights on Gaul, so as to reconnect the newly conquered province with Italia. But before he'd have the opportunity to do so, he'd find trouble brewing in the Balkans, an invasion of Slavic and Turkic tribes, likely fleeing from the Avars. This invasion would be successfully repelled by Belisarius as it had been in our timeline, potentially seeing the resubjugation of former Roman lands beyond the Danube through the establishment of client kingdoms. Late in his life, Justinian would initiate the reconquest of Gaul, but would not live to see it completed. That would fall to his successor Germanus or Germanus's son Justin. World history would be forever changed. The Byzantines succeed in reuniting Rome and maintain it through the centuries, not facing another danger capable of threatening the entire empire until the rise of the Mongols. Persia thrives in this timeline. Not engaging with the Byzantines in further large-scale wars allows them to focus on additional internal improvements begun under Khosrow, which later facilitate expansions into the east. Rome and Persia become partners in maintaining order in the neighboring barbarian lands, and put up a more effective fight against the Turkish, Mongol, and Islamic empires. Islam remains confined to Arabia in this world, as without the two great empires of the East exhausting one another, they are able to combat and contain the religious movement. Byzantium, recognizing the threat Arabia would now pose to their Egyptian lands if Islam were to expand into Africa, would themselves expand southward, annexing as far as the Horn of Africa and utilizing it as a major port for trade with the Far East. What in our timeline were merely the traces of the great Mediterranean Empire which inspired the various cultures of the West, are in this timeline the enduring and singular identity of Europe and the Near East. Through the tireless efforts of Justinian and the able men around him, Rome endures. The USFZ thanks you for watching. Big thanks to Bulgarian Empire Mapping for animating the scenario. Support your legion by liking the video, or join our ranks by subscribing for more. Mr. Z,